Hi everyone, welcome to Gateway Lectures. Here we have the solutions to the question quiz day 15, and today's topic is casting, welding and metrology. Here comes our first question. The desired volume flow rate of the molten metal into a mold is given. It is 0.01 meter cube per minute. The top of the sprue has a diameter of 20 mm and the length of the sprue is 200 mm. What diameter should be specified at the bottom of the sprue in order to prevent the aspiration? Okay, and what is the resultant velocity and the Reynolds number at the bottom of the sprue if the metal being cast is aluminium and has a viscosity of 0.04 newton second per meter square, and the density of the aluminium is given as 2700 kg per meter cube. Right, so into the mold cavity we'll be pouring the molten metal. So for the molten metal, viscosity was given, nothing but the dynamic absolute viscosity was given. Density of the aluminium is also given, 2700 kg per meter cube, and it is given the volume flow rate, nothing but the discharge into the mold cavity, is given as 0.01 meter cube per minute. So what we'll do is, first we'll see how the sprue will be look like. So this question is on sprue design. We'll see how the sprue will look like. This is generally our sprue design, and what exactly the purpose of the sprue is to allow the flow of molten metal into the gating elements, into the runner elements. Okay, they will allow the flow into the gating elements. Okay, so, and generally if there is no sprue, what happens is the hot molten metal which is poured from certain head will suddenly strike into the mold cavity, and there will be a possibility of erosion and also the spillage of the molten metal. So in order to neglect that, we'll be using the sprue here. Generally the sprue, the point where they enter into the mold cavity is from the pouring basin. Okay, is from the pouring basin, and from here it will be entering into the runner elements. So we'll be giving two points here. It will be the first point here, and this is the second point here. Okay, we'll be taking two points here to analyze them. And in the question given, the diameter at entry at the top as 20 mm, and also the length of the sprue was given as 200 mm. We'll be at today a bit fast because these questions are too lengthy on the production type. These are somewhat conceptual, taken the questions, and these are too lengthy here. So we'll be moving somewhat fast here. Let us try to understand. And the diameter at exit was not known, that we need to calculate, and also to calculate that the condition was given, it should prevent the aspiration. So the diameter should be in such a way that it should prevent the aspiration effect. It should prevent the aspiration effect. So initial diameter was given, and this is one given. And in the question, the volume flow rate was given, nothing but the discharge, that is 0.01 meter cube per minute. I'll be converting it into 60, that comes out to be 1.667 into 10 power minus 4 meter cube per second. And we know the volume flow rate here. Suppose if the molten metal liquid is not compressible, if it is incompressible, then, and also for the continuous flow, we need to apply the continuity equation. So for the continuity equation, we know A1, V1, nothing but rho 1, A1, V1 is equal to rho 2, A2, V2. Here rho 1 and rho 2 is same because it is incompressible. There is no change in density. A1, V1 is equal to A2, V2, and that should be equal to the discharge, nothing but the given discharge. In our question, A1 was known because the diameter was known. So from that, we'll be calculating the V1 value. V1 is equal to 1.667 into 10 power minus 4 meter cube per second upon. The value of A1 is pi by 4 into diameter is 20 mm, nothing but 20 upon 1000, that is 0.02 whole square. So from that we'll be getting our velocity value as 0.531 meter per second. You can make all the calculations. So velocity was known here. So the 0.1 velocity was known. And here the main important thing is to prevent the aspiration. What exactly is aspiration? The aspiration, nothing but the air aspiration effect. It is called as air aspiration effect. What is air aspiration effect is, suppose when you are making a fluid to flow in a pipe, at the entry, suppose it is having some pressure. And when it is flowing in a pipe, at any point in the pipe, if it is having a low pressure region, there is a possibility that the outside atmospheric air will try to enter into the pipe. Okay, the same way here, whatever the outside atmospheric air it is having, it will try to enter into the pipe, and it will be generating the vague regions in the molten metal flow. The vague regions are nothing but the regions of the high turbulence. Okay, and this creates the possibility of oxidative stress here on the in the liquid metal, and also this air which is trapped into the liquid metal enters the mold cavity, and while solidification there is a chance that we'll be having the blowhole defects and many such defects. there'll be a possibility of forming a porous solid structure finally. So this, that should not happen. So to avoid that, we should design a sprue in such a way that there should be no air aspiration effect. And we know air aspiration effect is happening because of pressure difference. What if we don't give any pressure difference? What if we maintain the pressure between 1 and 2 to be the same, constant? Then there is no possibility of air aspiration effect. So the, for to avoid air aspiration effect, the pressure at 1 should be equal to pressure at 2. And generally we know the pressure at 1 is nothing but it is open to atmosphere, it will be equal to the P atmosphere. Right, now the P, that points 1 and 2, pressures were known, volume was known, and also let this point 2 be our datum for reference to apply the Bernoulli's equation. This let be our datum. Then our Z2 will be equal to 0 and Z1 will be equal to 200 mm, nothing but 0.2 meters. So at the points between 1 and 2, the head possible values V1, P1 and also potential head was known. So from that we will be applying Bernoulli's equation from between the points 1 and 2. Applying Bernoulli's equation between 1 and 2. Okay, once by applying Bernoulli's equation between 1 and 2, we know it is P1 by rho g plus V1 square upon 2g plus Z1 is equal to P2 by rho g plus V2 square by 2g plus Z2. And we know Z2 is our reference, it is 0, and P1 is equal to P2, they both will be getting cancelled. And V1 was known in the question, we have calculated. Z1 was known 0.2 meters. So we need to finally calculate the V2 value. So V2 square upon 2 into G is 9.81. That is equal to V1 square. V1 is nothing but 0.531 meter per second square whole square upon 2 into 9.81 plus the Z1 we have taken, that is 0.2 meters. So from here we'll be getting the value of V2, and that comes out to be 2.05 meter per second. So this is the velocity to avoid air aspiration effect, and this is nothing but the velocity at the exit, nothing but the resultant velocity at the exit, nothing but the average velocity at the exit. So that is already, that is said to be calculated in the question. So we calculated the resultant velocity. So this is one of our, one of the answer. And next thing is to calculate the diameter at the exit of the sprue, at the bottom of the sprue. That again we will be using the Q is equal to A to V2 discharge equation. Our here now velocity is known, discharge was known, discharge is always constant in a flow. So A2 is equal to Q was nothing but 0.01 upon 60, and that upon V2 just now we calculated 2.05, and that should be equal to the pi by 4 into D2 square. So from this we will be getting the value of D2, and that comes out to be 10.17 mm. After calculation we will be getting the value of D2, and this is of the answer that is said to calculate in the question. What diameter should it have be specified at the bottom so that it avoids the air aspiration effect? And now D2 was known, and finally we need to calculate the Reynolds number at the exit, nothing but at the bottom. And we know Reynolds number is equal to rho V D upon mu, where rho is the density, V is the velocity, D is the characteristic dimension. And here, since it is like a pipe, sprue is like a pipe, so the characteristic dimension will be the diameter, and mu is the absolute viscosity. Okay, and these all values were given in the question. The rho was given in the question as 2700 kg per meter cube, 2700 kg per meter cube, and the velocity just now we calculated at exit is 2.05 meter per second into the diameter just now we calculated D2 10.17 mm, and here we'll be converting into the meters because all the values in are in SI units, and mu, the value of mu given in the question 0.004. So from that the Reynolds number at the exit, we'll be getting it as 14072. Okay, this is an ideal practical Reynolds number that should be provided for this proof. This is one of the answer. So the three answers which were required was already calculated. So we are entering the question number two. The question number two: for a constant current type transformer arc welding, the volt ampere characteristics of the power source. So we, whatever the power source we are having, for that the variation between the current and voltage is given. IT square is equal to minus 600 into V minus 60. If the arc characteristic, so at arc also we'll be having the current and voltage, right? Only because of that we'll be producing spark. So that is also given, I is equal to 20 into V minus 16. And also it is said that for stable arc condition, what should be the power required? Okay. And the second question is, if the arc length voltage are represented, so arc and length, we know the arc length and the voltage are proportional. Okay, the length of the arc is it will be depending upon the voltage, given to the circuit, okay, at the terminals of the electrode and the workpiece. Determine the optimum arc length for maximum power. So for using the maximum power, what should be the optimum arc length for the given condition? So we'll first understand what is a constant current type transformer. Why will be using it in arc welding? Generally, in manual arc welding, whenever it was designed, in nowadays we are having automatic arc weldings. In manual arc welding, the distance between, suppose this is the workpiece where we need to perform the welding operation. If suppose this is our electrode, nothing but a fuse rod, where it will be producing the arc, and this will be melted and all that welding process happens. So here this is called as the arc length or the tool tip distance or the arc length, and this will depend depending on this, the voltage required will also be dependent, will also be changed. Okay, so we've generally, to maintain this distance, a constant value for the given current and voltage is generally a difficult thing. So what we did is, we've designed a constant current type transformer in which whatever be the arc length difference, whatever be the contact length difference, it will having a high voltage difference, right? It will having a voltage difference. For any voltage difference, we will keep the current constant, so that at any distance, the same amount of power will be drawn into the welding process. Okay. This, once you read the theory, still it will be very clear. Just here to analyze, just to tell what the given condition is, I have explained this. So for any arc length, if we vary the arc length, whatever we do, the voltage will be varying. For that varying voltage, our transformer is designed in such a way that the constant current type transformer, it is also called as a droop type transformer, because droop means the variation between the current and voltage will be in a parabolic form. That is given in the question. For this type of transformer, they are called as the droop type transformers. For the droop type transformers, the arc length is varying, the voltage will vary. For that, the current we can't vary with the given power source. From the given given home power source or from the shop power source, we can't change the current value. Voltage can be changed, voltage can be regulated, current can be regulated. So to regulate the current, we designed this. And also, the current regulation should not be in a high variation, it should be in low variation, it should be very constant. So this transformer helps us to maintain the current constant even under varying the voltage. So this is designed. And we'll solve the first question. At the power source IT, that current characteristic equation was given, current and voltage characteristic equation. It is called as generally volt ampere characteristic, it was given. So, and also the arc characteristics, at the arc also the current voltage characteristic was given. So whatever entering into the, here will be one terminal, here will be one terminal connected. Between them, the current voltage characteristic is also given, 20 into V minus 16, it is a linear variation. So determine the power of the stable arc. So what do you mean by stable arc? Just now we discussed, the arc length cannot be controlled, but if it should be made stable, then our current, whatever we are having at the arc, that must be equal to the current at the power supply of the transformer. Nothing but the IT means I transformer, right? And but in the question, IT square was given. So what we'll do is we'll meld square on both sides. And IA in the question was given as, generally this is IA at the arc. So 20 into V minus of 16. That is, and its whole square, that is equal to IT square was given in the question as minus 600 into V minus of 16. Okay, once we solve this, we'll be getting a quadratic equation in this way. 4V square minus 122V plus 664 is equal to 0. So while solving this, we'll be getting two values of voltage. Okay, and one value will be 23.4 volts. And the other value will be 7.09 volts. So we got two values, nothing but the two roots of a quadratic equation. So we need to check which value is the correct thing for our given condition. For a stable arc condition, what should be the voltage? Depending upon that, we'll be calculating the power required for a stable arc condition. So the voltage was known. So first we'll check with V is equal to 7.09 volts. Is it possible or not? See, if in our I arc equation was given as 20 into V minus 16. Right, so 20 into the given V is 7.09 minus 16. And if you can observe this value, we are getting it as negative. And we know the current can't be negative. That too when we are applying at the electrode and workpiece. Right, it can't see the spark should be generated bit mean if the current is reversed, it can't be negative, it can be reversed. If it is reversed, the arc will be generated in between the workpiece and metal, that filler rod. Then the workpiece will be melted instead of the filler rod. But our purpose is to melt the filler rod. So the arc should be generated at the filler rod, right? So this can't be done. So in the other condition, other route is voltage is equal to 23.4 volts. So this is our voltage at the stable arc condition. And now we'll be calculating the current. Current when we calculated that IR is equal to 20 into V minus 16. Right, and the V is nothing but 23.4 minus 16, and from that we'll be getting the IR as 148 amps. Once the current was known and also the voltage was known, it is easy to calculate the power. Power is nothing but voltage into current, and that comes out to be 148 into 23.4, and that power value we are getting it as 3463.2 watts. This is our answer to the first question. We'll be answering the second question. If arc length voltage are represented by VA is equal to 30 plus 5.5L, determine the optimum arc length for maximum power. So here we need to take the maximum power condition, and for that maximum power condition, what should be the optimum arc length? So we will be taking them. It was given in the question, V is equal to 30 plus 5.5L. We are solving the second question. So V is equal to 30 plus 5.5 into L. Let this be equation number one. And also the power source, for the maximum power consumed, what should be the arc length? So for power source, the amp volt characteristic was given. IT is equal to, IT square is equal to minus 600 into V minus of 60. This is, let this be equation number two. And substitute 1 into, that means this value of V, if we substitute here, then we'll be getting it as IT square is equal to minus 600 into 30 plus 5.5L minus 60. And from that, calculating the value of I2, it will be under root of minus 600, 5.5L minus of 30. This was known. We need to calculate the power. We know the power is equal to IT into V. And V is nothing but the, it is changing with arc length. So it was also given in the question. IT is equal to under root of minus 600 into 5.5L minus 30. Into the voltage given in the question as 30 plus 5.5 into L. Right, and this is the power. And if you can observe, here our power is being the function of the arc length. So it is initially the function of voltage that we know. But with the given condition, we finally derived the power in the function of arc length. And now we need to calculate the arc length for the maximum power. That is nothing but dp upon dl is equal to 0. From this we will be getting the value of L. Once we, it is in the UV, so we differentiate between the UV, and we will be getting our value of arc length. And that arc length comes out to be L is equal to 16.36 mm. So at this arc length, our current will, our power will be maximum. So the product of V into I will be the maximum. So this is our answer to the question number 2. Not even we are asked to calculate the arc length. And here comes our question number 3. A hole and shaft system has the dimensions of 60H7M6. We will make the H and the H7 and M6. Generally, capital letters will be denoted for hole and small letters for the shaft. We will see it later. The maximum size of the hole in mm is. So what will be the maximum size of the mm? Hole in mm. The diameter falls in the step size of 50 mm and 80 mm. We'll see what is the step size and why we need the step size values of 50 and 80 mm. And here we have to calculate the maximum hole size. So for that, what we'll do is, it was given, say whenever these types of questions, it is given like some 30, it is given M7 small, sorry, 30 capital M7, generally hole will be always denoted by 7, M7 and small H6. Or if it is given 40 H7, same in this, like in this question, and it is given some M7 in this way, then important thing to note is whenever you find H in the given hole shaft system, that H, suppose if H is in small letter, then our hole shaft system should be designed for shaft base system. The shaft should be our base, means shaft should be touching our zero line. And whenever it is said, if it is given capital H, then it is our hole base system. Okay, so now in our question, capital H was given. So whenever you see H, if the H was capital letter, it is hole based system. If the H was given small letter, then it is a shaft based system. And both were given in H, then both will be touching the lower limit of the hole will be equal to the upper limit of the shaft. There is no deviation between them actually. That generally don't happen. These will be the questions, these will be the possibilities. So H7 was given. So thing we need to design on basis of hole basic system or hole based system. So how the hole based system will look like? We will take a fast diagram here. And this is our hole based system representation. This is called our zero line. Nothing but all the basic size, whatever given, 60. 60 lies at that line. And we'll be measuring every dimension from that line. And this is our hole. And this is our shaft. Okay. And H7 was given. What does H7 represent? H7 represent that great tolerance of IT7. If you see the number 7, it is nothing but great tolerance of IT7. Since we are asked to calculate about the maximum size of the hole, we'll just take this. And you see from the chart, the IT7 value will be equal to the 16 times of the fundamental tolerance. Okay. That you all refer some standard textbook, from there you can understand why IT7 is equal to 69 and what exactly is the why capital H and small H will be taking over shaft based system and hole based system. That all you can refer some standard textbook. I'm just giving some few introduction and starting with the question. So IT7 is equal to 69. If it is given IT8 or if it is given H8 here, then it will be IT8. Okay, then it will be 25 times of I, small fundamental dimension, and here IT7 is equal to 67. And how the IT7 is different? This is called as the tolerance of the hole. This IT7 for H7 is called as the tolerance of the hole. So this is the IT7. We need to calculate the maximum size of the hole, that is here. This distance means this 60, whatever base we are having, plus the IT7 is the maximum size of the hole. So for maximum size of hole is nothing but the basic size 60 plus the tolerance of the hole IT7. Okay, if you're taking on the shaft, suppose it is M6, nothing but IT6 here, and IT6 is nothing but 10 times of I. That all you can see from the standard table. And here we need to know this difference also. This is our lower limit of shaft, this is our upper limit of shaft, this is our lower limit of shaft. So we need to know that value also to calculate the maximum size. But in our question, we are asked to calculate the maximum size of hole, that is generally calculated by 60 plus IT7. So we need to calculate IT7. IT7 is nothing but 16 times of I. For calculating 60 times of I, we need to calculate first I. What is I? I is called as the fundamental tolerance, and it's given an empirical relation as 0.45 times cubed root of T, capital D, and that capital D is called the geometric mean of the step sizes. We'll see what it is. Cube root of D plus 0.001 capital D, and this is our empirical relation. There is no proof for us to this. We just need to remember only this I is equal to fundamental tolerance is equal to, and this D is called as the geometric mean of the step size. You know, the geometric mean of the step size here is between 50 and 80, so it is between 50 and 80. Okay. And if we calculate that, we'll be getting the value is 63.2 mm. And also remember, whenever we calculate the I value, it will be in micrometers. So we need to convert into millimeter. So what we'll do is, we'll divide it by 1000. So we'll do the calculation for I here. I is equal to 0.45 cubed root of 63.5. So 63.5 whole power 1 by 3 plus 0.001 times the 63.2. And this all comes in micrometers. So to convert that into mm, we divide it by 1000. Okay, from after doing that, we'll be getting our value of I as 0.001856 mm. So I was known. So only thing left was to calculate 16i. We'll do remaining calculation here. So 16 times of I, that is the IT7. So 16 times of I, we just know we have calculated 0.001856. From this, we will be getting our IT7 value as 0.02969 mm. Once after getting IT7, we know the maximum size of hole is equal to 60 plus IT7, nothing but 60 plus 0.02969. and that comes out to be 2969 mm. This is our answer to the question number 3. Here comes our question number 4. To measure the effective diameter of an external metric thread, included angle 60 degree of 3.5 mm pitch, a cylindrical standard of, okay, so here we are measuring our effective diameter of the external metric thread, nothing but we are measuring the pitch circle diameter of our metric thread, and which is having a pitch of 3.5 mm, and the metric thread will be having generally angle of 60 degrees, and we are using a cylindrical standard here. Why we will use cylindrical standard is, further we need to know what experiment is generally done with this, to calculate the effective diameter. Further, first we will complete the question. A cylindrical standard of 30.5 mm diameter and two wires of 2 mm diameter each are used. So here we are using two wires, nothing but the two wire method. This is called as two wire method or the two roller method. So two diameters are used, 2 mm diameter each are used. The micrometer readings over the standard. So the micrometer readings, when they are calculated over the standard, we are getting it as 13.3768 mm. And also over the wires, when we do it on the wires, we are getting it as 12.2428 mm respectively. So we need to calculate the effective diameter of thread in mm. So what we'll do is, generally this micrometer, whatever we are using micrometer, it is not completely accurate. It will have some correction factors to be done. And to calculate these types of correction factors, we generally will be using a standard specimens. Suppose, so I will use our standard specimen is to know the any if there is any error in the micrometer. Suppose here we were given our standard cylindrical specimen, and it is given that it is having a diameter of 30.5 mm, and also it is having the wires placed on it having each 2 mm diameter. And here we know these are the standard values, 30.55, 2 mm, 2 mm are the standard values. So no need to measure them. But here we need to measure the pitch circle diameter. We'll see what is the pitch circle diameter. We'll see what the difference between pitch circle, major diameter and the minor diameter here in the next slide. Here we are making this calculation, right? So whenever we place a micrometer here, micrometer means it will having two tongs. It will be in a C shape. It will be having two tongs. You can observe. You can just see the functioning of micrometer. So whenever we measure the micrometer, it should give the exact reading of the 30.55 plus 2 mm plus 2 mm. Nothing but 34.55. But here, our micrometer, what we are using, is giving a reading of 13.3768 mm. Then you can simply say it is giving the error value. It is giving a wrong value. And how much error it is showing from the actual value is, error is equal to 30.5 plus 2 mm plus 2 mm is the actual value. It had to show. But it is showing some less value. I mean, it is having an error of 30.5 plus 2 plus 2 nothing but 34.5 minus 13.3768, that is equal to 21.232 mm. That is, it is showing a value lesser of 21.32 mm. Mean it is having an error of 21.232 mm. That error may be due to some screws used in the micrometer, or else the proper alignment of the tongs. This all, it all depends on the complete values. So, and it is having this error. But when we are using the same micrometer on our screw thread to measure the pitch circle diameter using the two wire method, here also it will having, so it will give some reading, and sure it will give the wrong value, because it is having an error of 21.232 meters. So it will give a wrong value, and that wrong value it is giving is 12.2428 meters. Means it is giving a value of 21.32 less. And it is finally giving value of 12.2428 meters. Then what will be the actual value of the micrometer if a correct micrometer is used, which is having zero error? Then it should be equal to 12.2428 plus this error, whatever we are having here, 21.232 meters. Sorry, it is all in mm. And that comes out to be the actual value, m actual, it is called as m actual or m. And that is micrometer reading, and it comes out to be 33.366 mm. That is, it has to give a value of 33.366 mm, but it is giving a value of 12.2428 mm. Means it is giving a value of 21.232 mm less than the actual value. This is called the error or the correction factor. It is called the error or the correction factor. So to calculate the correction factor only, we will be giving this standard specimen. So whenever in the question, if you are given standard specimen, you need to note first. First you need to check, is there any error in the micrometer from the standard specimen. After checking that, we will calculate the actual value of M here. Then we will proceed into the question. And we need to know few terms used in the derivation of this micrometer. Derivation you can refer from standard textbook. I will be giving the final formula here, what that will be used. And I will represent the few terms here. The terms are, these are our wires, right? Wires are having some diameter. And this end point of the wire into the screw thread, these points and the distance between these points is generally denoted in the derivation as capital T. Okay, so you remember this, whenever it is given T, capital T, that is the distance. And here this is the center of the wire. Okay, and here we'll see what exactly the pitch circle diameter. This is our center line of that screw thread, and this is the top line which is we are having here, which is passing from this top point, is called as the crest part or as the peak part, and the bottom part is called as the trough part or as the root part. Okay, and the distance between the crest part, between two crest parts in the top and bottom, is called as crest diameter. Here suppose here the same, in the same way we'll be having don't mind me with the diagram here, in the same way between the two crests here we'll be having the distance, and this distance is called as generally D major diameter. Okay, and between the two trough points or the root points, the distance is called as the D minor diameter. And we know for all threads or all gears, we'll be having a pitch circle, nothing but the imaginary cylinder that is passing over this. That is the imaginary cylinder that is passing over this. That imaginary cylinder will be having some diameter, and that diameter is called as the pitch circle diameter, and it is generally somewhere here. Let our imaginary cylinder will be somewhat bigger. This is here. So this diameter is called as the pitch circle diameter, and this is the D effective that we need to calculate. It is called a D effective or the pitch circle diameter, PCD. Okay, that was done. And just now we said when we keep two rollers, the distance between the two points on the rollers, at the base points between the rollers. Suppose here we place one more roller here. Here also we will be having the base place. And this value is T. And how can we write the value of, and whenever we place here the micrometers, generally the roller will be somewhat upward. Whenever we place the micrometer, the reading in the micrometer is the M actual value. And how we calculate the value of T here? Simply we can say T is equal to M minus of 2 times of DW, because this is the DW value, and here also this is the DW value. Okay, if this is DW and this is T and again this is DW, then the total value will be M is equal to T plus 2W, 2 plus 2DW, then T can be M minus 2DW. So this is all the required things. And also we need to note the angle here, subtended angle between the threads. Generally we'll be measuring here, it will be 2 alpha. Okay, and then the half angle will be alpha. That is the metric, the tread angle. And the tread angle in the question is given as 60 degrees. Then 2 alpha is equal to 60 degrees. Then alpha is equal to 30 degrees. Okay, so these were the basic things to be known here in the wire, two-wire method. Three-wire method also, it will be somewhat close to this. Generally, two-wire method will be using for large pitches, and three-wire method will be using for small pitches to get the accurate value. So we'll just proceed to the question. So we've just calculated the value of capital M actual there. So first we'll calculate the value of T, and we said the T is nothing but M minus 2D into DW, and the M we've calculated it as 33.366, nothing but the actual value of the micrometer into the diameter of the wire was given as 2 mm. From that we'll be getting the value of T as 29.366 mm. So after T was known, we need to calculate the PCD or the effective diameter. And generally we, after derivation, we've got the effective diameter, or PCD is a simple derivation you can observe from any standard textbook. We got our PCD or the D effective diameter, and that comes out to be T plus DW into 1 minus of cosecant alpha plus P upon 2. P is the pitch. Pitch is nothing but the distance between two consecutive crest or two consecutive trough. So P by 2 into cot alpha. Right. So here the T was calculated 29.366 mm plus DW was given in the question 2 mm. 1 minus 2 alpha was given in the question as 60 degrees. Then our alpha will be 30 degrees, right? We'll be using this here. 1 minus cosecant of 30 plus P, pitch was given in the question as 3.5 mm divided upon 2 into cot of 30 degrees, right? From that we are getting our D effective or the pitch circle diameter. That was asked to calculate in the question, and that comes out to be 30.397 mm. Okay, and this is our answer to this question. And finally comes our question number 5. Interesting question. First we'll read the question and then we'll see what were the cases, what were the questions that were asked in our GATE examination previously. We'll see the difference between that question and this question and how good this question is. Okay, so first go through the question. What is the weight required to be kept to compensate for the forces during the pouring in a sand casting of a cast iron pipe? So we are making a cast iron pipe which is having a 12.5 centimeter outer diameter and 10 centimeter inner diameter. So it is a hollow cast iron pipe. If it is a hollow cast iron pipe, then in a mold we have to use a core element to allow the formation of hollow component, right? So we need to take the core element, right? We'll finally draw the diagram and I'll show what the core element look like. And it is said that it is having a length of 180 centimeters. Okay, the metal head is about 20 centimeters. We'll see what is metal head here. While the molding flask size used for this purpose is 200 into 25 into 20. So we'll be using a molding flask. In the molding flask, there is an accommodation for the what we call this runner and also for the sprue. There will be for the riser and the sprue, which gives the accommodation to the riser and the sprue, is called as the molding flask. Nothing but the cope element, nothing but the cope part of the complete molding setup. Okay, and a metal head is given 20 centimeters, molding flask dimension was given. Take the density of the core sand. Since we are making a sand casting, the core sand density was given 0.0165 Newton per centimeter cube. And the liquid metal density to be, liquid metal density also given 0.0771 Newton per centimeter cube. If you can observe, the liquid density is generally weight density, so we'll denote it by rho. The weight density of liquid metal was given and it is seen to be greater than the sand casting. So whenever the weight density of the liquid metal is greater than the sand casting, when we pour the liquid metal into our mold cavity, it will try to apply a buoyancy effect by buoyancy force on the core element, because this liquid metal will be surrounding the core element. Once it enter into the mold cavity, the hollow space of the mold cavity, it will surround the core element. Since the liquid is having high density and the core element is having low density, it develops a buoyancy force on the core element. And also, here we are not asked to calculate that buoyancy force. Here we are asked to calculate what was the total weight that we need to keep on the complete casting in order to support the forces which are produced in it during the pouring of sand. So what all will be the forces produced? We'll see with a proper diagram what all will be the forces produced. And there is a significant effect of this metal head. We'll see what effect it will have. Before that, we'll see the questions that were asked in GATE examination previously. These were the two questions asked in GATE examination previously on the same type of like core element and also the buoyancy effect. The first question was asked in GATE 2008, that is in production and industrial paper. In sand casting of a hollow part of lead, okay, a cylindrical core of diameter 120 mm and a height of 180 mm is placed inside the mold cavity. Okay, the densities of the core element, core material and lead are 1600 kg per meter cube and 11300 kg per meter cube respectively. The net force in newtons, the tends to lift the core during the process of molten metal will be. So we need to calculate the net force that is acting on the core element due to the pouring of the metal. Here also the molten metal is having higher density than the higher density of the lead. So we are using a lead casting here. So it is having higher density than the lead. So it will have a buoyancy force. We need to calculate the buoyancy force here on the core element first of all. And the second question in GATE 2014 is an aluminium alloy density to 2600 kg per meter cube casting is to be produced. Okay, a cylindrical hole of 100 mm diameter and 100 mm length is made in the inside the casting using a sand core. So here we are using a sand core of 1600 kg per meter cube density and then what is the net buoyancy acting on the core. See, in the both the questions we are asked to calculate the, here we are asked to calculate the force that tends to lift the core, and here we are asked to calculate the net buoyancy acting on the core, nothing but the force that try to tend the core. So these both questions how we'll solve is, generally this is our mold cavity, right? Inside our mold cavity, this mold cavity is generally made completely with sand. Inside our mold cavity, this will be our object that we need to produce, right? This is our core element, which is made of sand. This is totally made of sand, okay? And also there will be a hollow space left between them, and the remaining thing will be completely filled with sand, and here will be your gating elements, okay? This completely will be filled by our sand. Okay, it's completely filled by our sand. Whenever we send the molten metal into this gating element, this molten metal keeps filling, keeps on filling this gap. And after filling the completely, it will be going into the riser. So while filling, what happens is the molten metal is having high density than this core sand. Nothing but here we are using lead casting, it is having high density than lead casting. So what will happen is this molten metal which is having a higher density will try to produce a buoyancy force upward on the core element. And also we know on the core element, there will be weight acting on the core element. So here we need to calculate the net force acting on it. And the net force will be generally upward, we'll see how it is. Here, first of all, the buoyancy force. We know the buoyancy force is nothing but the weight of the fluid displaced. And weight of the fluid displaced is nothing but the density of the fluid, nothing but the density of the molten liquid into G into the volume of the fluid displaced, nothing but the since it is a submerged body, the core is a submerged body inside the molten liquid, it is a total volume of the core. And also how will we take the weight of the core, nothing but again rho vg, but here the rho is of sand. If it is made of sand, it is sand. If it is made of lead, it is lead. So into the g into volume of the core, right? And this buoyancy is acting upward, and this wt is acting downward. And if you can observe, rho l is greater than rho s. Therefore, the buoyancy force will be the dominant. Therefore, the final net force acting on the upward is nothing but F buoyancy minus weight of the core. And F buoyancy is nothing but V core into G into rho L minus V core into G into rho M. Okay, from this, we'll be writing it as V core into G into rho L minus rho M. So all the values were given in the question, we'll substitute here to get the final net force acting on the core element. That is an important thing. It is on the core element. So the same we'll be doing for this question also. So in this way, we can solve these gate questions. These are the simple tasks. Just to apply the two equations, we'll be doing that. But this question, what we've taken, is completely different. Here the condition looks like this. This is our setup. And the middle part here is called the core. And generally, this core is made of sand. So here the sand I am representing with white particles, so that you'll understand the material distribution overall. And also the complete sand casting will be made of again white particles, nothing but the sand, core sand, not white exactly, core sand. And the bottom part is the also made of core sand. We'll be making the pattern inside, and we'll be removing the pattern, then we'll be forming this, and we'll be providing a core for hollow objects, right? So here the molten metal enters here into this, and the molten metal, after passing through the gating system, it will be entering into the cavity that is formed in the mold. So this cavity, it will be completely filling the mold cavity, and generally this core is supported by core prints, say suppose, but here we core prints in the question was not given, so we'll be taking just core, and we'll find the forces acting on them. Generally forces here will represent with some other color. So we'll see what are the forces acting here. Due to this molten metal, we already discussed in the gate questions, there will be a buoyancy force acting on this core, and it will be upward. And also here in the question it is, a metal is having some head of 20 centimeters. So what happens is, when the metal is having some head, when it is poured from with certain head of 20 centimeters, it is having high potential energy. And once the metal flows in and enters into the mold cavity, it is suddenly brought into rest. So because of this, it produces some forces called metallostatic forces, right? Due to the high temperature of molten metal, there will be internal forces. Due to that high internal energy, there will be forces generated. Due to the convection currents and everything, there will be forces generated. that forces will try to lift this core element or lift the complete mold setup, which is lying above the partition line, part line. So it will lift. So there will be a metallostatic force. Like generally, that metallostatic force, whatever here, will be acting in the mold cavity in which the molten metal is filled. So on the complete mold cavity, there will be a metallostatic force. We'll represent it here somewhere. There will be a metallostatic force acting. So these both were the forces. One will be the net buoyancy of the core and other will be the metallostatic forces. We'll see how we'll calculate the metallostatic forces. And the one more force here is on the top part. This top part is called as the cope, right? It can be called as the cope or else it can be called as the molding flask in which our sprue and our riser, everything will be designed. It is called as the molding flask. And this is also the molten metal which we enter into this will also tend to lift this cope. So in and this cope, whatever here is also giving some weight. Since the cope is made of sand, sand will have some weight. So it will giving some weight force downward. So there are three forces that we need to calculate here. One is the buoyancy force, net buoyancy, not exactly buoyancy, net buoyancy, and also F metallic static forces, let it be Fm, and also weight of the cope, okay, that is acting downward, right? So we will calculate one by one forces, and first we will calculate the net buoyancy forces. Already in the previous case we have discussed the derivation, that is nothing but volume of the core into the density difference between the liquid and the sand and into gravity. But here in our question the weight densities were given, so no need to take the value of g here. And first we'll calculate the volume of the core. What is the volume of the core? And the volume of core is, you know, this is our core, right? There we have represented this is our core, and core is here is a cylindrical object. So pi by 4 into d square. The d is in the question, it is given 10 centimeters is the inner diameter, 12.5 centimeters is the outer diameter, right? So 10 centimeters mean 10 square into the length. Length is given as 180 centimeters. So into 180. Okay. And that volume of the core, once we calculate, it will come out to be 14137.16 centimeter cube. When is the volume of core, and then we'll be calculating FB net. This is your first four. Let it be value 1. And it will be acting upward. FB net is equal to volume of core 14137.16. 14137.16 into rho L, it is given in the question 0.0771 minus rho sand 0.0165. No need of G multiplication here. And this F buoyancy net, the value comes out to be 856.7119 newtons, and it is acting upward. So this is our first force we have calculated. The second force is the metallostatic force. So you remember always, whenever you see this case of metal head, you remember this metallostatic forces, F metallostatic. And how this metallostatic force is calculated is, it is the area projected of the mold cavity, whatever mold cavity in which our molten metal having high energy is entering. So mold cavity into the metal head. From what head it is entering, metal head, pressure head, into the density of the liquid metal, liquid molten metal, right? So here in our question, the area of projected is nothing but here our area is, mold cavity is a rectangle, and a rectangle is having the height of 180 centimeters, and also it is having an outer diameter of the final object to be produced is 12.5 centimeters. So the projected area will be here 180 into 12.5, and the metal head in the question is given 20 centimeter into the density of the liquid was given 0.0771, and that comes out finally comes over F metallic, that is acting upward, and that value comes out to be 3469.5 newtons. Okay, this you need to remember whenever you see this type of questions where metal is having some head, you need to apply this. And not everywhere, but whenever it is asked to calculate the total weight that to be placed on the casting, then you need to do this. And next, so these two forces which were acting upward is calculated. Now we need to calculate the weight of the core. So we know generally weight is nothing but rho gb. And here no need of taking g because weight density was given. So here is rho into volume of the, here it is not core, it is cope. Volume of this cope, because the cope is having sand. it is also exerting weight force on the molten metal, nothing but the molten metal that is entering. It is restricting the molten metal to lift the core. It is restricting the molten metal to lift the casting. Okay, so the weight will be acting on the cope downward, and that rho is nothing but the rho of sand. Okay, because the sand, the cope is made up of sand, right? So rho of sand was given as 0.0165, and the volume of cope here it is given in the question 200 × 25 × 20 cm. It is the mold flask volume. This is proof runner. Everything will have a very less volume compared to the size of the mold. So we need not subtract them. So 0.0165 into 200 into 25 into 20. Okay, once we calculate, we'll be getting the weight of the cope as 1650 newtons. Once the weight of the cope was obtained, and all the three forces were obtained here, weight of the cope was also obtained. It is acting downward. So all the three forces were known. This is the second force, this is the third force, and previously this is our first force that we gave our numbering. We will calculate the net upward force acting, because we need to support upward force will be more here. We'll see that net upward force is nothing but Fm, nothing but the metal static forces acting upward, plus F buoyancy, nothing but the buoyancy forces net acting upward, minus the weight of the cope that is acting downward. This is the total F net on the mold, on the casting, actually on the casting surface, that is acting upward. And once we calculate this, Fm was known, 3469.5, plus F buoyancy acting upward is 856.711, minus the W weight of the cope here we've calculated 1650 newtons. From that we'll be getting our F net upward as 2676.21 newtons. So in order to make our casting properly, and also in order to avoid the lifting of the top surface of the casting, nothing but separation of the cope, we need to provide weights on the additional weights on our mold surface, nothing but the casting surface. Okay, and that weight should be equal to a magnitude of 2676.21 newtons. Okay, and this is our answer. In this way we'll be doing this question. This was some advanced level of the question that was asked in GATE, because in the GATE we have seen only these types of questions till now were asked. These are very, very easy when compared to the question we have taken. So I have taken this question just to let you know what exactly the concept of metallic static forces. This is all for today. These were the solution to the 5 questions, day 15. Thank you. Thanks for